science and art. To most people, they sound like complete opposite concepts, and perhaps even contradictory disciplines altogether. However, it hasn't always been like this. Throughout history, science and art have actually developed together as one. Great minds such as Leonardo da Vinci devoted their lives not just to the development of science, but also to painting, poetry, music, literature, and all the things we today think of as only for the eccentrics among us. At some point in the last century, we began to separate these two massive cultural and evolutionary concepts, so far so that we now see them as even rivals.
I'm Matt Akinber, and I study physics all the way in England, so I guess you could call me a scientist. But as a former art student, I've always been interested in what we conceive as polar opposites. So I'm here in Accra, in Ghana, to find out just how much these two seemingly opposite disciplines actually connect. It was Da Vinci himself who said that art is the queen of all science. So why do we now see it differently when maybe they're actually two sides of the same coin? Now, in a way, my interest in both disciplines has led me away from what I was told was the social norm, because from a very young age at school, we're told that there are either hard-working, academic types of people, or eccentric, more creative types of people. But if you take a look around any science museum and look through the cabinets, you'll find that it's not too dissimilar to any sort of art gallery. Some of the artifacts that you may find would not look particularly out of place in a contemporary art studio. Some of them are purely functional, but others are actually rather beautiful in their own right. So for example, back in England, there's a unique group of people belonging to the Pylon Appreciation Society, celebrating the beauty of electricity pylons.
Now, this may sound ridiculous to most people, but when you think about it, the huge structures symbolise the engineering power of every country's electricity system, without which we wouldn't be leading the lives we do today. They were not designed to look good, but instead are purely functional. They are the cheapest and most efficient way to transport power, so in that sense, there is some beauty to them.
For a much more impressive example, take a look at the Large Hadron Collider in CERN in Switzerland, which was set up to find out more about the standard model of particle physics, which is essentially just trying to find out about how the millions of atoms that make us up and everything around us are built up of even tinier things called protons, neutrons, and electrons. And in order to find out more about this, we had to recreate the conditions just a second after the Big Bang, which was the moment that the universe was created. So we built a 27-kilometer ring deep underground made of superconducting magnets that fire protons in either direction until they collide in the middle and form new particles.
The results of these particle collisions form stunning images, which are often displayed in both galleries and museums alike. They are the real-life patterns and tracks of the tiny particles that make all of us up, which can easily be viewed as modern art. They are the building blocks that make not only us up, but also the very paint and canvas seen in the gallery.
Even here at Independence Square in Accra, it's really easy to see how architecture actually is a perfect example of all this, because all of this was written on a piece of paper by an artist, but then to bring it to life, you had to involve builders and engineers and scientists. Now, a lot of science goes into these cameras, but with it, you get something quite beautiful.
So we now really are starting to get a sense of how science is quite related to art, but does it work the other way around? So I'm off to the Artists Alliance Gallery in the Bali Beach to find out more. So we're here at the Artists Alliance Gallery at the Bali, and here we can see an entire gallery full of art that's been inspired by people's cultures and technology and science. So let's go and take a look. So I've just been taking a massive look at this amazing art gallery. So can you tell us a bit more about it?
Okay, we're currently at Artists Alliance Gallery at La, in Ghana. We are currently standing at the exhibition hall of Abladi Glover, one of Ghana's renowned artists. Apparently, he just had his 80th anniversary exhibition in London at the October Gallery. So this is basically one of his a showcase of his works. He mainly paints, as I see here, is a Muslim prayer group praying. So you see the palette, and he paints with a palette knife and pure oil on canvas. And you can't, you usually don't get it till you stand a little bit further from the artwork. So the next one, the red one that you see here, is a red townscape. You see the roof, and when they're doing the around noon, the sunlight shows on the asbestos. You see all these red lights and reflections. And the other one here is a seascape. When you go to the beach, Labadi Pleasure Beach, you see a lot of people swimming, so you see their hands and everybody swimming in. And basically, he's known for most people trying to collect the red forest. I see the yellow forest behind me, and then you see a peoplescape and a marketscape. That's what you see behind me.
So obviously, quite a lot of this art is quite traditional, but can you see anything like linked towards the technology side of the culture?
Okay, mostly what we do have here, we have a little technology, but it's mainly a sculpture piece done by J.C. Sappho. He's a Ghanaian who's based in New Jersey. As you can see, it is a sculpture piece, that's one, a gun, and a sword, and a cross. But I'd like to talk about the more figurative part of it, which is a human hand that is turned into two people kissing. But because we don't have a furnace in Ghana, all his works are done outside and shipped into the country. And basically, that's the technology that gets him. He needs the furnace to smelt it and to mold it before he can get into the ship. So basically, that's also from J.C. Sappho's artwork.
So you can obviously tell that there's been a cultural change just as a result of our technology that's influenced the art world. So.
Definitely, it's a Western cultural change. Because if you say you're going to mold this thing or sculpt this thing, using the traditional rudimentary tools is going to take forever to get this thing.
Yeah.
And I'll ask you another question when you look at it. Do you think a Ghanaian will have a daughter or a son marry an artist? Most of them won't do that because they will think, an artist, can he make money and look after you? But yet, it's another form of occupation. You are self-employed, you are an entrepreneur, you market your own work. Instead of going to 9 to 5 to work for an establishment and come home, you could be laid off. But here, you can even, with art, you can even do it as part-time. Yet I'll ask you, a funny thing is that when you look at the perfumes we put on, the most expensive part of a perfume is the bottle. It's a sculpture piece.
What we're doing is what you have seen
here.
That's exactly what we're doing. We try to encourage young artists studying art, but the circumstances you describe, they are forced to go into seeking for jobs, looking for jobs and so on, so that they can eat.
So would you say that the art that you've seen here, especially in Ghana, has actually changed due to like technology in the last few years? Because that's like a massive cultural change.
I now meet people who are doing some things with this kind of what they call computer.
Yeah.
I think honestly, for me, it's like photography. Photography can be art, yes, but it's like the person holding the pen. Is that not the pen that is the art, the artist? It's the person behind it. So, yes, in the same way, the computer can be used, but it hasn't. It has never interested me.
Yeah, so do you much prefer the traditional style then?
Art must come from within, and passing that through a gadget like a computer, I can't imagine.
Yeah.
people are coming and showing me things they are done. That's interesting. Nice. Some are really nice, but I can't see it. The problem is that we teach art as a subject too early. We don't allow people to develop into areas that they can use their creativity in the area. If you're a doctor, you can be an artist, hey. You can work creatively. You can live a creative life.
So this gallery is full of really deep connections to science through all this art. But among the traditional styles, for example, this portrait here,
The artist has clearly tried to make a real-life representation of the world through careful observation and repetition. But in stark contrast, take a look at this, which is a portrait of Sir John Sonston, who was one of the scientists who decoded the human genome. And this was painted by Mark Quinn by taking a sample of his DNA, cutting it into little segments, and spreading it out over bacteria. Now, it's quite hard to see on screen, but this work, which is on display at the National Portrait Gallery in London, England, shows an intricate web of genetic structure. Although it may not look like your average portrait, since there are no distinguishable features visible, you could argue that this is in fact the most realistic portrait ever made. It displays everything that makes John up, all the instructions and genetic coding used to bring him into the world, and shows his ancestry right back to the very beginning of the universe.
Well, I know the stuff that we just saw in there isn't for everyone, because not everyone can get excited by art, but there was a really interesting study that was done, in which a mathematician's brain was analysed as he was looking at a beautiful equation, and the same parts of his brain were shown lighting up as when an artist sees a beautiful painting. Which just goes to show that although an art gallery is doing it in a much more obvious way, we all get excited, we all get creative about certain aspects of the world around us. So why can't a complex mathematical explanation of the world in a really short equation be as beautiful as anything in there? Right, well let's have a really obvious example and take a look at Einstein's famous E equals mc squared, which essentially relates mass to energy through the speed of light. And although this may seem like nonsense to most people, it actually has a really profound effect on how we continued with science and technology from the 20s onwards. But to really explain this, I think I know a place that's a bit more up my alley. So basically, Einstein said that everything is relative. So if I measure someone's speed way over there and position, it can be completely different depending on my relative position and speed. And this was also his basis, the basis for his theories on gravity. And Einstein said that gravity was essentially putting this bowling ball as the sun onto a trampoline, which curves the very fabric of space and time together. So everything is orbiting around the dent that the bowling ball is creating in the trampoline, and that affects not only the space of things, but the time it takes for it to get there. So things moving closer towards it are actually getting faster and faster. So space and time and gravity itself are all linked to just E equals mc squared.
But it's important to remember what we actually mean by the arts, because it's not just paintings on canvas. It's in poetry, literature, music, any creative aspect of the world around us. So it takes a certain mindset to be able to do that. Like, for example, I was challenged by my poetry society at university once to come up with some sort of nonsense poetry. And that may seem really easy, but it was turned out to be quite a challenge, because creative mindsets always find meaning and understanding from absolutely anything. So no matter how nonsensical it may seem, there's actually deep meaning to anything you can find. So in a way, that's exactly the same as scientists.
Now, the way scientists use their creative minds differently is usually by examining the inner workings of the world around us, asking how things work the way they do, and why things behave a certain way. An easy example of this is sound. It's all around us. We can't escape it no matter how hard we try. But when you really sit down and try to ask yourself, what is sound? You'll find it's not an easy question to answer. Sound waves move along as a longitudinal wave. For a noise to be heard, something must vibrate, which compresses and decompresses the air between the object and the receiver, just like pushing on a spring. There are also transverse waves, such as water, which move along in a much more expected fashion, like pushing a spring up and down. But if this still sounds like boring science to you, and not creative thinking at all we have to do is add an artist into the equation. Swiss photographer Fabian Offner used these simple principles of waveforms to create unbelievable images by using coloured particles resting on a speaker system. These stunning photographs are not even an artistic perception on reality, which puts many people off art to start with. but rather a real-life representation of what is physically happening in the real world, brought to life using the visions of both the artistic and the scientific alike. So it's pictures like these that really help to blur the line between the two seemingly opposite realities. And he does exactly the same thing with the iridescence of soap bubbles, preserving the short-lived sculptures.
And the exact same principles can be applied to really anything, just like the water waves, which are moving as transverse waves, and even light. Now, this may seem really hard to imagine, but the light that we're using to see absolutely everything around us is actually a wave. So it's a mixture of an electric wave and a magnetic wave moving as a transverse wave together, just like these water waves. So we're already starting to see how we can use really simple scientific phenomena to try and create art in their own right. So anything from sound to water to light, anything that we can see in our everyday lives. But what if we try and go a little bit further and look up there? Now, I'm studying astrophysics, but sometimes I even have trouble trying to imagine just how big the universe is. Now, there are quite a few planets in our solar system alone, and even that is quite far away. So if we imagine that this is our sun, now obviously this is quite a lot smaller, but if we put that here, now the closest planet to the sun is Mercury, and it's quite a small planet, and that, on this scale, will be about here. So if we imagine this is Mercury and that is the Sun, now that distance may not look like that much, to be honest, but if we imagine that that Sun is shrunk down to a 190 million to 1 scale, then that size is actually quite large. So every pace that I was taking is actually corresponds to 3,600,000 miles. So this distance is actually about 57 million kilometers. Now we've got Venus, which is quite similar in size, so we've still got a tennis ball for that. And that would go about here. Now, again, this may not seem like much, but that is actually 108 million kilometers from the sun. And now it's finally time for Earth. Now, we're quite far away at 150 million kilometers from the sun, and we're actually one of the close ones because there's plenty of other planets down there. So we go about there. So next up we have Mars, the red planet, at 228 million kilometers away, and that would go about here. And it's already getting kind of hard to see the coconut sun over there, but what if we go even further to Jupiter? So let's take a walk. So here we are at 779 million kilometers away from the sun, and I don't know about you, but I can't even see it over there. So, and this is only Jupiter, so we've got plenty other planets all the way down there, but I think it's getting a bit silly to go even further. But the most important idea here is that everything in space is so far away, and that's just in our solar system. Then the most important thing to remember is that our solar system is only one star. So all our planets are revolving around the sun, and that sun is only one star in an entire galaxy called the Milky Way, made up of millions of other stars, and that galaxy is only one of billions of other galaxies way up there that all have millions and billions of other stars all inside them. So I guess the point is that there's a lot of stuff up there, and if you can't make art with that, I don't know what you can make it with.
Just take a look at some of the stunning images from the Hubble Space Telescope of everything from galaxies to nebula, which are giant clouds of dust and gas up in space where new stars are formed. Some of these images are so unbelievable that you could almost imagine that they were painted by an artist.
And humans have been doing this since the dawn of civilizations, really, finding paintings and signs and all the constellations and the stars, like Orion the Hunter, bears, kings, all their ancestors. And although obviously you can't see any of them right now, it just goes to show the imagination that you have to be able to perceive all the science that you may read in a textbook. Now, you may not realize it, but art has always been massively influenced by our science and technology. So take, for example, the turn of the century in the 1900s. Art back then was still massively traditional, but the technology side was going through an industrial revolution, which was changing everything about how we lived our lives. And the art world actually responded to this brand new world.
Just take a look at Picasso's First Communion, painted when he was only 14 years old in 1895, which looks very traditional. In stark contrast, just take a look at Les Demoiselles d'Avignon, painted in 1907, and then The Weeping Woman, painted in 1937. This massive change is a direct reflection of the massive industrial changes between 1895 and 1937. Matisse responded, going from women reading in 1894 to the portrait of André Derrien in 1905, and even further to Icarus in 1947. Marcel Duchamp responded, going from this to this. Umberto Boccioni responded, going from this to this. A fantastic example of the way modern art has responded to cultural changes as a result of technological advancements is Andy Warhol's famous paintings of 32 cans of Campbell's condensed soup on display at the Museum of Modern Art in America. Painted in the 60s, it was Warhol's comment on the world around him, reflecting boomtime America after the Depression.
It was the start of the consumer revolution when supermarkets were suddenly displaying thousands of brand new products that had never been seen before from overseas. So painters and artists have always painted things from their everyday lives, like towns, people, bowls of fruit and flowers. So all Warhol did was use this new consumer revolution to make a comment on the booming capitalist society at the time. And this all led Warhol to become one of the kings of a new art movement called pop art. And to justify this new movement, Warhol said that the Queen of England and any celebrity all drink Coke and eat Campbell's soup, and no amount of money could buy you a better one. So for him, that was a perfect influence of all the new consumerist technology that was going around at the time. And it's clearly an influence that we still see today. And this sort of influence has happened since as long as we can remember, even way back into the cavemen, who started a rudimentary form of science by making spears to hunt, and who conveyed these ideas by painting on walls. So in this way, art and science together have always been the twin engines driving us forward as a species. So we've already seen how art and science can be reflections of one each other and bounce off each other's ideas, but we can take this even further, because in 2008, a team of scientists were assembled to do a study on how the arts actually affect our brains. And they produced a correlation between progression in art and progression in science, which means that the creative aspects needed for artistic subjects actually improved and helped our understanding of science, which means we can use art not just as a pastime, but actually as a way to increase our understanding of the scientific view of the world. Not only are art and science sometimes influenced and reflected by each other, but we've actually seen that art can actually improve on science. And to find out more about that, we have to go back to school level and to see how we teach our kids. So I'm here at the Cosmos School in La Paz to find out more. So I'm here with one of the teachers called Samuel, and so can you just tell us a bit more about how you teach the kids here?
Well, thank you very much for the question. You know, this school, most of the time we look at the understanding, imagination of the children. Now, most of the children try to create something on their own. So mostly we don't spoon feed them with what we have, but most of the time we engage them in the classroom, we ask them questions, and then they try to provide answers. Some of them also try to engage themselves in extracurricular activities, not only in the classroom. So mostly we take them outside to look at some of the things that we talk about, and then they try to picture in their mind if those particular things you're talking about are not around. You try to picture them and try to find out how those things look like. And apart from that, if those things are around, how they can interact with those things.
So as an English teacher, were you ever actually encouraged in science when you were at school? Or was it always separate for you as well?
No, as an English teacher, you know, back in school, I had an interest in science. Yeah. Because I had a belief that everything around us has a bit of science to it. You know, because the world now is being moved by science, especially when you go to the field of technology.
Yeah.
You know, it looks like everything is now about science, the internet, you know, the mobile phones, the laptops, the various applications we have on the net and all that. So I believe strongly science is something that everybody must develop a passion for.
So what made you make the leap from science to an English teacher?
Well, I think basically it was because apart from the fact that I had a passion for science, what I actually wanted to help the children around me develop was how to communicate very well.
So it's a very important thing to have there.
Yeah. Exactly.
So is there any way that you're trying to sort of mesh the two principles together at this school? Because obviously from a very young age, science and art are obviously opposites. You sort of get filtered out, all the students, to different categories. So is there any way that you can try and improve on that and make them a little bit more interlocked?
Of course. Basically, when we talk about science and English, students always have the idea or the mentality that they are two separate fields.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly, yeah. And it shouldn't be merged. But, you know, in this 21st century, you cannot separate the two. The two must always go together. You know, because, as I said earlier, no matter how good you are at communicating, you must use a particular medium to communicate. And the medium you're going to use most of the time is something that's inspired by science.
Yeah.
You know, for example, if you don't know how to use the mobile phone to communicate on phone, you wouldn't be able to communicate using the phone.
Yeah.
So, exactly. So, if you're good at speaking very well, good at communicating, good at interpreting what people say, because you are going to be using these modern facilities to achieve the aim of communicating, you have to also develop the interest in science.
I like science because science is a subject which needs a lot of concentration and sit down learning. Because if one is not concentrated and serious, well, one can never do science. And as a human being, God created us to use our brains. And with science, one can use their brains.
Simply, so I prefer art.
Why?
So because it's like nowadays, modern day Ghana, everything is about science and everybody's is studying science. So, and in my family too, there are only science people in my family, so I want to stand out as the only person who will be a visual art person.
Okay.
I prefer science to arts.
Why?
If we look at our world today, science rules, and almost everything we use in this world today is done as a result of the application of science. So I know that if I learn science, I'll be able to improve the world better than someone who learns arts.
I prefer arts.
Why?
Science is a system of obtaining knowledge through observation and experimentation. But in arts, like, even though knowledge is obtained in science, in arts you obtain, like, as the name implies, general arts. You obtain a general knowledge on almost all the things that covers humans, that is in relationship with the life of humans, anything that, yes, that's the reason why I like arts.
Science.
Why?
Because science is like, is what is ruling the world now. Because everything is like science. And then if you do science, you'll be able to like switch from another course to another course. If in case maybe you did medicine and then like you are not able to do it to your profession, or you are not able to get to that part of the medicine you wanted, then you can switch from that one to another course.
I prefer art to science.
Why?
Because as for me, I prefer, you know, I have the passion for art. And I want to be a journalist in the near future. And as for journalists, they're like, sometimes they tour around the world to see what's going around and also, you know, explore.
Oh, as for me, I prefer science.
Why?
Because if you study science, you are seen to be someone important in your society. Because science deals with, if you study science, you can be a doctor, you can be a pharmacist. And with that, you are saving the lives of others.
So we've seen how both art and science have always been the two driving forces between all the cultural changes in our modern world today. Not only does art serve as a mirror to science's achievements, it actually helps science by designing anything from cars to planes to architecture as a way of transforming a scientist's ideas from just an equation on paper or an engine in a bonnet into beautiful aspects of our everyday lives. Now, we can go even further with this by saying that art could even help with proficiency in science, and science itself can be seen as art just without an artist's perspective at all, looking at all the Hubble telescope pictures and particle tracking. So it's always been a beautiful symbiotic relationship. Without one or the other, we wouldn't have everything we have today.